Hi, I'm Valarie Traynham. I was diagnosed with multiple myeloma in 2015. So being a patient advocate, I'm driven by that because I want to be able to guide others through the process. When I was diagnosed, I did not have someone to go to. And I think that's very important when newly diagnosed patients have someone that they can go to, ask questions, find out information, and find out where to go for good, relevant resources. I'm just so excited at the work that Dr. Grant is doing because it's much needed. It's a, you know, area that needs focus, and she's doing a wonderful job with getting that focus out there. She focuses on a population of patients that oftentimes are overlooked, and they are in the myeloma world. It's very important for that population of patients to be looked at and cared for and really understand what they are going through. So Dr. Grant is from the University of North Carolina, and she focuses on geriatric multiple myeloma health and research.
Thank you so much for having me. What really drew me to this type of work was out of this love for really trying to bridge this gap in terms of the disparities that we see existing within not only outcomes, but also survival for Black and white patients with multiple myeloma. Unfortunately, because multiple myeloma is also a disease that impacts older adults, we see this compounding effect, especially for the Black older adult with multiple myeloma. And so it's really important for us as a research team to address some of these healthcare access barriers, which really largely drive the disparate outcomes that we see in multiple myeloma. So we presented two studies here, or really three studies. And for the first one, we really wanted to understand what barriers do patients and their caregivers encounter when trying to seek care for multiple myeloma. The top takeaway from that study is that many of our patients report that there's really a delay in getting the diagnosis of myeloma. And this really results in them going to multiple specialists with their symptoms. Oftentimes, patients reported being dismissed by their doctors and being chalked up to "it's just getting older," and then repeating labs again in 3 months. And so from this particular study, while we identified other barriers, including financial barriers, we do recognize that there is a need to focus on how we make the diagnosis, ensuring that patients are getting the diagnosis on time, which would allow them then to enter into a care pathway where they can begin their treatment and minimize any chances that they will have any poor or adverse effects from multiple myeloma. In terms of the other study, we wanted to look at factors that influence the participation in clinical trials for Black patients in particular. And so we did this by looking at the perspectives of patients with multiple myeloma, as well as their hematologists. And one of our main takeaways from this is that the patient and their relationship with their doctor is really critical when trying to decide about if a patient is going to be offered the opportunity to participate in a trial. And based on these findings, we do recognize that there is a need for more targeted interventions that address several steps in terms of communication between patients and their doctors to ensure that we have the best chances of offering clinical trials to a diverse patient population.
I do have one question I want to ask, because I heard a lot about clinical trials and, you know, how can we get more minorities involved in clinical trials? What is that like for the older population that you see in the clinic?
Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, overall, when we think about increasing representation in clinical trials, we are coming up against two compounding factors. One is the older adult, and then is the older adult who also identifies as having Black race. For me in the clinical practice, one of the things that we try to do is to not only look at patients' chronologic age, but we also look at the functional age of patients, meaning how well are they able to do their activities and to get around on a day-to-day. Because that, I believe, in addition to age, are probably better than to assess eligibility for these particular patients for clinical trials. In terms of Black representation or increasing representation of minoritized populations, it is important for us to realize that myeloma does tend to affect an older adult population. Therefore, we cannot really distill out and think about age and race separately, but we really should be thinking about these two things together. Therefore, our efforts to increase representation should be geared towards the older adult population, as well as thinking about the racial, ethnic, and minoritized populations.
I wasn't aware of everything that was going on in the world of myeloma with the older population there. So for a newly diagnosed older patient, how would you advise them? You know, it's so much going on. They're getting the diagnosis. They're trying to make it to the clinic. And how would you advise them to just stay positive and just, you know, look for the good in the situation that they're facing?
Yeah. So that's a really great question in terms of, you know, thinking about when someone is newly diagnosed, what advice would I share with them, especially for older adults? And I think the thing that is really important that I've seen come out not only in our research, but in my own clinical practice is really the need to have a social support system. This social support in our study, we looked at informal caregivers, who were oftentimes spouses and in some cases, adult children. But I really do think that having that support when you're first diagnosed is really critical because you have, in essence, the second set of ears, second set of eyes to help you with the amount of information that you're getting, help with scheduling, you know, helping to monitor for any potential treatment related side effects. Beyond thinking about the social support, I think it's really important for patients to also seek knowledge about multiple myeloma from credible resources. You know, read as much as possible what you can about this disease, about things that you can expect, and then come to your provider's visit prepared with having those questions ready to answer. Things like clinical trial participation, if your doctor hasn't mentioned it, I think it's really important for patients to take that first bold step and say, you know, I've read about clinical trials. Do you think this could be a potential option for me? So this really moves into this idea that we want our patients to not only have a really great social support system, but we also want patients to be empowered to be able to ask the questions that they need of their physicians without feeling fearful or intimidated.
So yes. Dr. Grant, I'm so glad you said that because that is one thing that as a patient advocate, I always try to tell newly diagnosed patients, find reputable material, find out everything that you can about the disease because don't be afraid of it. Yeah. You know, it's something that you're going to be living with indefinitely. So Dr. Grant, we know that trust in the African American community is that's a big deal. Yeah. And that's what we are focusing to raise trust and build trust in the community. Mm-hmm. As a physician, what do you find are some of the things that patients are mainly dealing with? I know I was listening to something and they talked about words matter and how you talk to patients and understanding patients and, you know, the words that you use and also the words that the patient uses and understanding and gathering information. Tell me a little bit of your thoughts on that.
What we've seen in our studies time and time again is that there is this legacy of medical mistrust that has been brought on by past research events where Black patients were intentionally harmed by the research enterprise. And so it takes quite a while to be able to reverse those effects. Things that we've learned from talking to patients, talking to caregivers that can help close that trust gap is really working on our communication style as physicians, making sure that we're using empathic communication, letting our patients see that beyond the doctor title, that we also are real people with real lives and lived experiences. And don't be afraid to sometimes pull back that curtain and let patients see that. That kind of relationship between patients and their providers really helps to build up the trust. I think of a particular quote from one of our studies where a patient said that it's all about relationship. And if we need to build trust, we really need to be focused on the relationship. And that particular participant went on to say that really they believe that the physicians could benefit from relationship building training. And that really stuck with me because I recognize that trust is so difficult to address. But these are some of the strategies that as a physician that we can do to at least start to build that and close that potential gap. When it comes to think about the research, there are different strategies that our team used to really help foster trust and to help engage Black participants in our study. And I think some of those strategies have been described in the literature, but really it's about having a team that is representative of the population that we're trying to engage. And again, just helping them to realize the value of this research on why we need to do this, especially for the Black community. So to tie it all together, in terms of thinking about access, I think we need to recognize that access to healthcare is dependent on several steps. So this includes the patient's ability to perceive their need for healthcare, and they need to be able to seek out those services, reach the services, pay for the services, and then engage with their healthcare provider. So thinking about many different points along the way, I would encourage patients that if you are experiencing symptoms that you're concerned about, and potentially you're seeing your provider and your provider is, you don't think your provider is necessarily answering or addressing those questions, they have to think about costs of medications, but also when they're coming to the cancer center, the cost of parking, the cost of gas, and all of these things are really additive for patients, especially when they're on a fixed income. And so this idea about having to pay twice was centered around the need to pay for all of these other healthcare services while also attending to the high costs associated with paying for parking at the health center. Don't be afraid to maybe talk to somebody else, talk to another provider maybe, and do some additional research and see if there is potentially another option for you to have your symptoms examined. In terms of just thinking about other economic impacts, so thinking about things like parking, don't be afraid to tell your provider that, hey, this is challenging for me to really pay for parking, or I'm having challenges just paying for my medications. Because honestly, sometimes in the visit, time is so short that we don't always have the time to ask if you were having financial concerns. And so we don't want that these financial challenges are a limitation to you getting your care on time.
So how often do you have patients that they experience that is their lived experience? Mm-hmm.
We actually see this I in my practice, especially quite often, that patients would express concerns about their ability to pay for parking. Sometimes it's a bit of a challenge knowing what to do in those scenarios. There are some efforts now at our cancer center to try to provide more accessible parking in terms of financial costs and reducing the cost of that, but it's not always widely available to patients. So I think this is something that we see quite often in practice. It's not uncommon at all for patients to be concerned about the cost of parking. So I encourage you, don't be afraid to talk to your providers. If you have concerns, make those concerns known. And that goes from even when you're first presenting before you're diagnosed and you're concerned about it, keep sharing those concerns with your provider. If you're having financial challenges, continue to share those concerns and ask about available resources, because there are more resources out there than sometimes patients may actually think or may actually have knowledge about.
So Dr. Grant, thank you for joining us today and going over all of this. It's so important what you do in the field of myeloma. I mean, it's what we're dealing with is it's meaningful. It's life. It's life impacting. So it's very important that you understand, you know, if you're not being treated right or you feel that something is not right, say something, because it's not okay. And you have the right as a patient to have something done about that. You are in control of your health. So don't settle.